Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Big Cove Presbyterian Church's Outdoor Worship. My name is Pastor Kim. Good to have you here out there. Good to have you here right here with us right now. It is crisp. People are wearing scarves and a little bit of coat. We're even wearing a little bit of gloves when we need them. But it's lovely because the sun is shining, friends, and God is with us. Isn't it amazing that no matter what we do out here, we've only had to cancel once due to rain? That is amazing. And we're all here ready to worship God together. We've had one announcement for those of you at home that might be interested. There will be a movie night tonight here at the Pavilion, 5:30. Be there or be square. It's I Can Only Imagine film about Mercy Me's main singer and how he wrote the song and what it meant to him. It's a great, great, wonderful movie. So hopefully we get to see you. Now, y'all, with all this beautiful weather, with the crispness in the air and the beautiful fall leaves, are you ready to worship the Lord? Give me an amen.
Amen.
Debbie and Ralph.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Invite you to join me in the call to worship. You can find it in your bulletin. Praise the Lord. Give thanks for God's goodness.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Happy are those who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times.
Save us, O Lord, and gather us from among the nations,
that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise.
Come and worship God.
Choose you now.
Pray with me. God, we are celebrating you here today. We ask you to come into this worship space and be with us, O God. We praise your name and celebrate who you are, O Lord. We celebrate you as a presence in our lives that we have covenanted with, O God. We celebrate you for being present, but not just that, O God. We celebrate you for the joy you give us, for the strength you give us, for all that you give us. Help us today to take what we need from this service, O God, because you feed us through the music, through the prayers, through the word. You feed us, O God. And help us to bring that all together in our hearts and souls and minds and strength to feed your people. In your name we pray. Amen. Sorry, my eyes are leaking because the wind is blowing and my eyes are leaking. Now comes the time in our service when we welcome one another in Christ. Can we do that now? So, I'm seeing a flash of color out here. I'm seeing a flash of red, which means anyone with the color red on, including masks, gets to stand up and say hello to everybody.
Woo-hoo! How y'all doing?
Hey, y'all doing, they're saying. Hey, y'all doing? It's wonderful. Anybody with black on gets to stand up and say, hey. Hello, everybody. Hello. Anybody with blue on any kind gets to stand up and say, hey. Blue? Hello. Hello. And Bob, you have brown on, and you still have to stand up and say hi to everybody. Can you do that? That's wonderful. Wonderful. And as we move into our song, I'd like to get an amen from everybody who feels that God is so good.
Amen.
Even in times of stress, friends, even in times of a pandemic, even though we're separated by the miles sometimes, our God is so good. Are you ready, Debbie? Are doing sign language on purpose. That is actually true ASL, and we're working our way into having an interpreter at some point. We do have a member who is going deaf for you all out there, and that's one of the reasons why we're doing this, is because we're celebrating life and celebrating everybody and inclusivity, and so we do that here at Big Cove.
Our first reading this morning is from Psalm 106, verses 1 through 6 and 19 through 23. Praise the Lord. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty doings of the Lord, or declare all his praise? Happy are those who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, when you show favor to your people. Help me when you deliver them, that I may see the prosperity of your chosen ones. That I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory in your heritage. Both we and our ancestors have sinned. We have committed iniquity, have done wickedly. They made a calf at Horeb and worshipped a cast image. They exchanged the glory of God for the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt. Wondrous works in the land of Ham, and awesome deeds by the Red Sea. Therefore he said he would destroy them. Had not Moses, his chosen one, stood in the breach before him to turn away his wrath from destroying them.
Now we're moving into Exodus 32, 1 through 14, the golden calf. Familiar story to everybody. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down, Aaron his brother and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Well, take off the gold earrings that your wives and your sons and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So all the people went and took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed to him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, Go down from the mountain, because your people whom you brought out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They've been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up and out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone, so my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you, Moses, into a great nation." But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "Lord," he said, "why should you burn your anger against your people whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth?' Turn from your fierce anger, God. Relent and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, 'I will make descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give you descendants to the land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever.'" And the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. The word of the Lord. How many of you have bought a car from a dealership before? Raise your hand. Okay, out there. Okay. And how many of you enjoyed that experience immensely? Raise your hand. Only two out there, and there's only two, maybe three. Okay, we got three going here, not everybody. Okay, now how many of you knew the salesperson really, really well you bought the car from? One, two, three only. How about up there? Not too many. But in the end, you get a car, right? After you sign a contract, of course, you sign an agreement that says for this much money, you get a product and you get something for your money. You've arranged mutually to enter into an agreement where each of you gets something from the contract. You promise this to each other by what? You sign the papers. It's how your life, pretty much. All right, now how many of you have ever been married? Raise your hand. Out home, too. Okay. Now, most of us didn't sign a contract, most of us, for this kind of agreement, right? But I'm sure most of you made some kind of promises, correct? Promises in your wedding vows. Now, today, it's common to receive premarital counseling from the pastor who agrees to marry you. During the counseling sessions, something usually comes up in the discussion. It always does in my counseling sessions for couples about to get married. We talk about covenant, what a covenant means in a marriage. A covenant in a marriage is a three-way agreement. It's a covenant between the couple to each other and then from the couple to God. Why don't they just sign a contract? What does God have to do with it? Let's talk together for a moment about what a covenant really means. Now and in the time of Moses, okay? We'll get a little help from our friend. His name is Jeffrey Krantz, and he wrote The Beginner's Guide to the Bible. He has some great information for us. He says that when the Bible mentions a covenant, it's referring to a strong, sincere agreement between two parties. And there are some common themes in a covenant. One theme. Covenants usually make two into one. When two parties make a covenant in the Bible, right, they're joined together, and then they're identified with each other. Here's another theme. Covenants in the Old Testament often involve families and bloodlines. In the Bible, two parties can make a covenant that's intended to last for generations. All the generations that follow agree to that covenant. Think about it. David in the Bible, what did he do? After Jonathan died, he made a covenant with Jonathan. Remember that? And after Jonathan died, he kept covenant with his family. Here's another theme. Covenants, they're not easily broken. That a break a covenant is a very serious thing. Jonathan actually calls on God to kill him if he doesn't alert David of danger. That's part of the covenant. You see, when the Bible speaks of covenant, it's usually more than just an alliance. It's certainly more than a transaction of goods and services. It's a bond that God himself holds people to. But those are covenants between people in the Bible. Let's talk now about the covenants between God and man. Jeffrey Krantz says that these are the really important ones, right? They're the ones that make up the stories in the Old Testament. There are a few things that make these stories special. God is his own witness. Think about it. When someone swears an oath to God, they've got a Bible, right? Things are going to fall off the place. We've got a lot of wind here, people. That's okay. It's part of the covenant. See, God is blowing to let us know he's in covenant with us, right? But if you're in the courthouse and you're putting your hand in the Bible, you're swearing to God, right? But God can't do that. God is his own witness. He can't swear on something higher than himself because he's the highest. And some of God's covenants, they're completely unconditional. Look at the one of Abraham. I will give you the stars and generations to come. So going back to our wedding couples, we as pastors try to see and help the couples see that their vows to each other are covenantal. That it's more than just a promise. It's a vow with God as a witness. Remember how Jeffrey Krantz said that the bloodline is affected by the covenant? That generations will be with that and uphold it as well? It's the same thing in marriage, my friends. The couple's families have to accept each spouse as children of their own now. That's why in a marriage ceremony in the PCUSA, in the Book of Common Worship, it says this. Families of the bride and groom during the service. As you witness these vows, these promises between the bride and groom, do you give your blessing to this couple, and will you do everything in your power to uphold them in their marriage? This is a covenant between families now, a sort of adoption. At Ralph's and my wedding, this section was really, really important to us. It was very important to us. And we expanded that vow from our families, our personal families, to our church family. So when our church family was there to hear our vows, and they said that too. They stood up and they vowed to help us. We were relying on them to intercede, to help us if anything went wrong. We wanted them to stand up in covenant with us and to stand firm and help us to stand firm together. It's deeper than a promise. Not much different, really, than the covenant from thousands of years ago with the Israelites and God. And that's it. What the heck happened to the Israelites when Moses goes up on the mountain? He's gone a bit too long as they party? I mean, really? What's with his brother Aaron helping them to make a golden calf? This sounds incredulous. The people of Israel have entered into a covenantal relationship with God, but they grew impatient waiting for Moses to come down the mountain. What if he doesn't come back? What if he asks us to do more? We want to negotiate our covenant and change it, they cry out. So they build a new god. Doesn't seem to be able to solve their problems. They grew a new god, but it's not unlike the gods that they had seen in Egypt, right? Very familiar to them, these animal gods. And they can bow down and worship it because, frankly, it's easier. But when God sees what they're doing, he's ready to not just put them in the corner for misbehavior, my friends. No, sir. He is ready to annihilate them. He is really ticked off. You see, God has made a binding covenant with the people of Israel. He's established himself as their God and them as his people. The relationship comes with certain expectations, with benefits for the Israelites if they uphold their agreement, and consequences, my friends, if they don't. But Moses, he's able to convince God to change God's mind about the total annihilation of all the people. Why do you think Moses was able to do this? Why do you think Moses was able to change God's mind? God. One word. Relationship. God and Moses have walked together. Moses isn't afraid to talk plainly with God. He has from the very beginning. Who me? Don't pick me, he said. God knows Moses and his fears and his anxieties and his strengths, they know each other. 2017, I entered into a covenantal pastoral relationship with New Market Presbyterian Church. They were really tiny, and after a while, they really couldn't sustain a pastor. But I loved them, and they never found another pastor. So when I moved to Big Cove, I still stayed on and still am moderator of their session, and I keep the relationship to care for the 6 people who are left, and they care for me. I just buried 2 of their members 2 months ago. We have a covenant with each other that you just can't break just because our contract went away. Does that make sense? When we're talking about covenants in the Old Testament, discussing what they meant, and every single one, whether it was a covenant between humans or between God and humans, they knew each other. They had relationship. A covenant is formed, my friends, through relationship. You have to know the person you're forming a covenant with intimately. So that said, we need to know God if we're asking God to covenant with us. So it all comes back to one thing, no matter how much we dissect the many passages in Exodus. Do we know God? Do we know Jesus? Jesus Christ was brought to us from the Father God to establish a new, more intimate covenant with us, God's people. An author named Sam Storm says it this way: the law of Moses was very clear in stating the thou shalt nots, but there was nothing in the law itself that could empower the people to obey it. The law of Moses told the people of Israel what they should and should not do, but it was never capable of supplying them with the internal energy or the spiritual power to obey. So friends, what now? In today's world, what now in today's world gives us the spiritual power to obey God and his law? What is it? A gift, my friends. An incredible gift. The Holy Spirit was given to us and indwells in all its members. We've been given the power and the strength by the Holy Spirit. We are in relationship now with the Trinity, the Holy 3-in-1. We all belong and are one in Christ. One in Christ. Here we are, all connected to each other, either in person or online, connected by one thing, my friends, our faith. Our faith connects us together and puts us in covenant with each other. And that is a blessed thing. Galatians 3, 28-29. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring and heirs according to promise. The old covenant was established for hereditary Jews, those that belong to the Israel nation. But now, with Christ, the blood in our veins no longer matters. The only thing that really matters is the faith in our hearts. If we trust in Jesus, we are members of the new covenant. We could be male or female, slave or free, Jew or Gentile, doesn't matter. We, through our relationship with Christ Jesus, are a member of the new covenant. But remember that caveat, knowing our Lord, knowing God, friends. Take the time, be with God. We need to know our Lord. Amen. Knowing you.
righteousness, and I love you.
Complicated out here with the wind. So if you see pauses, just because we're trying to keep our pages down, we're trying to wipe away the tears in our eyes. And sometimes the tears are because of the wind, and sometimes it's because this is a wonderful emotional time to be in covenant with God and covenant with all of you. Now comes a time in our service when we give back and we give prayers to God. We give them up right to God, Lord, and our Lord. So I'm asking if anybody here has any prayers that they offer, they ask to give up to God today. Any prayers from the floor here? Anybody? We have a lot on our prayer request list today. Many people. We have one of our members, Julie. Three members of her family have come down with COVID, and one is very bad, and it's really hard for her. Her parents are also suffering from COVID, and they're older, so we have a lot of concern there. Anyone at home, if you have a prayer request, please send it right in. We'll be there at 12 o'clock today. Just type it right in. We'll pray for you. If it's a personal concern, no problem. Type in pastor. Go to your email, pastor.bigcovechurch@gmail.com. pastor.bigcovechurch@gmail.com. We'd be happy to answer your prayers. That said, let us all go into prayerful time with our Lord and Savior. Let's bow our heads. God, we thank you for this time together outdoors in the breeze. It's nippy, oh God, but oh my goodness, it reminds us that we are alive. And during COVID times, oh God, when we're isolated and we're kept in our homes so much, even though it's chilly, it reminds us of you. Every breeze, everything that goes through our hair, every smell of the leaves and the trees out here, oh God, remind us of you, that we are not alone, that you have covenanted with us, and that we are yours and you are ours. And God, by giving us the new covenant of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have helped us so much, oh God, to be able to then take that old covenant, put it in our hearts, and go new, and to join with others in faith to be one with you again. Lord, we have a lot of people to lift up today. And you know what's in our hearts, oh God. You know what's wrong with everyone. So the congregation is going to lift up out there and back here. And lift up all these names. We lift up Brian and Dawn and Kathy and Tennant and Diane and Betty and Jimmy and Dexter and Sandy and Mary and Dr. Sandy and David and Dan and Chuck and David and Sarah and Beth and Martha and Adam and Terry and Shirley and Teresa and Peyton and Billy and Shreya and Kimberly and Roy and Virginia and Kim and Becky and Destiny and Brian and Ann and Faye and Jerry. And now those, oh God, we lift up to you that are affected by COVID. We lift up Lois and Debbie and Jeff and Layman and Carol. We lift up the healthcare workers, the first responders, and others on the front line. We lift up those that have small businesses that are struggling, oh God, because we know also that their livelihoods are at stake. We lift up all the economic issues, Lord. We lift up our country. We lift up our political system, oh God, that we can have unity and not stress. And all that, Lord, we bring back to you. And we ask in your name that you listen to our prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
It is now the time in our service where we take up our tithes and offerings.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're warm, yes. That warmed us up.
Please pray with me. Lord, how great thou art. We ask that you please take the blessings, offerings, and contributions that we have brought to you this morning and use them as a sign of our continued dedication to our covenant with you. May they be used to further your kingdom here at Big Cove and beyond. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So this song is a little bit of a change of pace. Basically, whatever we go through, God will always keep his covenants to us. This song is a prayer, so please pray with me. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with, he's with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear, whom then shall I fear? Never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. And I can see the light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you. Through the storm, oh no, you never let go. Every high, every low, oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Friends, our God never lets go of us. I was just sitting over there hugging my husband really hard because he was shaking because he's cold. And it reminded me a lot of what happens with our God. God doesn't let go. When you're shivering and you have hard times, God doesn't let go. We're in covenant with God, my friends, and in covenant with each other. What a beautiful thing. Go now knowing your Lord Jesus Christ indwells within you as the Holy Spirit. And from that Holy Spirit, you gain strength and wisdom. May you leave this place knowing that you are loved and then share that love with others. Amen. I know.